Let's go live back to Canberra now, because I'm happy to say Julian Assange's father, John Shipton, joins us live. John, thanks so much for your time. We've spoken intermittently over the last couple of years. When did you first hear about this latest development? Where were you? Tell us everything.
I was lying in bed. I wake up pretty early. I was reading the internet, and I get a feed from the Washington Post, and then Gabrielle rang and said, Julian's on a plane. That was it. Early rise and out of bed and start ringing my friends and relatives that Julian's free.
Wow. John, so was it Gabrielle that told you, or did you read it in the press first?
Yes. Okay. No. Gabrielle actually said that Julian is on the plane. Yeah.
Wow. So were you given any kind of forewarning that this was happening, or was it kept in a very tight circle, not even including you until he was actually out of prison?
Oh, no. I didn't know until that time. Yeah. I've never been... My job has always been to generate support amongst the supporters and confirm support and expand the arguments to free Julian in Australia and United States, the Europe and South America. So that's what we have done, yeah.
And when you had that conversation with Gabrielle, did you have to get him to repeat it? Did you not quite believe your ears at the time?
Yeah, I said, hello, and he said, Julian's on a plane. I mean, you couldn't mistake any meaning there. Like, it just came out straight away. Julian's on a plane.
And what was your next question?
I didn't have, I was stunned. I didn't have a question, and then he gave me a series of instructions.
Well, what were they, John?
That I'm to go to Canberra to make myself available. The government will contact me, and there may be a press conference, and we go to the airport to greet Julian, and then after that to say hello, maybe have dinner, that sort of thing. Yeah, right, just to make myself available, and everybody will boss me around.
Well, I'm sure you're happy to do that, if only today in the next couple of days. And here you are, and we thank you so much for giving us your time. So we'll get to the court proceedings in just a moment, but you are in Canberra. We expect Julian to be landing in Canberra. Have you been given an indication as to what time that might happen?
I think... I read somewhere that 7:30, but my instructions are to meet Stella at her hotel at 5:30. So that's what I'll do.
Yeah. And what do you think you'll say to him?
Welcome home. Yeah, that's all. I mean, it'll be... I don't know how he's travelling, It must be very... pretty stressy for Julian, and pretty moving and emotional. He's always, loved Australia, and particularly landing in country Australia, where we are imbued with the sensibility of the bush. Even though many of us these days live in the city, we have flying into Canberra over the rolling hills. It's very beautiful.
Have you been able to speak to Julian on the phone? Because I know Stella was able to FaceTime him late last night, but have you been able to do the same?
No. His last phone call was last week, I think, and that's a 10-minute phone call from the jail. No. Since then, we haven't spoken.
And that last phone call you had with him from the prison in London... Was there hope? Was there any kind of indication that this deal might come from the Biden administration? What did you talk about a week ago?
I just spoke about the phenomenon of state-to-state relate. Well, usually gossip, you know, starts the conversation. And then, you know, because I'm probably a bore, you know, I speak about serious things. So the phenomenon of state-to-state relationships once Australia entered the fray. So we had three friendly states, all members of Five Eyes, working out how to return Julian home because it was demanded by the people of Australia and the Parliament of Australia and the Prime Minister and government.
John, we've seen footage of Julian. We've seen him enter the court now. He has formally entered that guilty plea, guilty to one felony charge. That court proceeding underway right now in a very remote part of the Pacific, the Mariana Islands, who everyone has quickly become acquainted with, very quickly. But I guess this is a big moment for him as well, still having to plead guilty to that one felony charge. All of these things are always a quid pro quo. As I mentioned, the footage of him after having spent 5 hours, 23 hours a day in a 2x3 cell in a maximum security prison in London, I've got to say I was a little bit shocked to see him look so well physically. Were you, and what is his frame of mind like at the moment? Or how was it a week ago?
Well, you know, pretty good, crisp, and, you know, optimistic, you might say. And also, you know, you have to divide these things into two distinct packages. Your question is very strong. And that one element, the profound element, is that when you come down here to Earth, you only get a bit of time to spend with your loved ones. If you spend 15 years in one form of incarceration or another and the last five in more or less solitary confinement, you get to understand that, you know, the time has been taken from you at the prime of your life as a man and to spend time with your children. The other, so you must make decisions surrounding that, and that is what the government in its wisdom and Julian's lawyers have pursued. So he will be free to live the beauty of an ordinary life. The other is state-to-state relationships, and involved are the Department of State, US Department of State, US Department of Justice, the US CIA and the US FBI, and these belonging, the institutions that are enfolded into a superpower. So negotiating the political and diplomatic and legal arrangements to get Julian home required, in my view, considerable skill carried out by Stephen Smith and Ambassador Kevin Rudd under the direction of Prime Minister Anthony Albanese. And this goes greatly, in my view, to their credit, to be able to do that.
Let me ask you one final question, John, and it'll be quite a homecoming. And I think most Australians, and I don't speak on behalf of them, of course, we're not one homogenous group, saw that justice was not done swiftly in this case and therefore denied him many years of what you describe as that ordinary or the beauty of an ordinary life. He still divides opinion in many ways. Some say he shouldn't be described as a hero. Others say that perhaps he was reckless with his information and endangered lives. Do you think over the years that he has come to accept that perhaps things weren't done the best way possible. Does he have regret, do you think? And what do you think he'll do with the rest of his years?
Gee, that's three super
big questions for you this morning, John.
Okay, let's then I answer them in some sort of rough order. The first one is when those executives of state of the United States and the UK stand on their bully podium and say that those men who exercised their power to destroy Iraq and kill a million people, and they say that Julian may have endangered lives, I think that that's grotesque, bordering on an obscenity, that they exercised their powers to the destruction of an entire country at the cost of a million lives, and then make those sort of comments. This is, well, shocking. Then the other, what will, whether Julian has regrets, I don't inquire. And and if I take myself as an example, my regrets have always been that relationships that I treasured didn't go so well, or that sort of thing, surrounding, you know, the mothers of my children and other people that I have felt very fondly and sentimental towards. So I imagine Julian may be the same and regret not having a fuller engagement with those he loved because he was banged up. That's what I imagine. The third question, what will Julian do now? And, you know, his future, let's say, is in the lap of the gods and in the capacities that he brings to his life. I just hope that he gets to feel the sand in his toes and watch the wattle bloom, which will happen, you know, at the end of this month. That's my hope, really, yeah. Because, you know, in essence, having time, what we call quality time with our children, or those moments that they, you know, the ladies, my lady, women friends, have a range of photographs on their dressing table. And each of those photographs is of a particular period that had meaning in their lives. And so I just hope Julian gets to do that. It's pretty simple, but very beautiful.
It's all very simple in the end, isn't it, John? Well, we wish you the best of luck, and look after that right arm. You're going to have to give him a left-handed hug, and I think it might be a bit of a squeeze there. You might be in danger of further injuring that later this evening, John. Thanks so much for your time. We really appreciate it, as always.
Thank you. Bye. Bye.